many times we are referring gesture also, like walking, running, jogging, jumping, all sort of things. So in this, I will give practical implementation. I mean, especially we have used on the tiny ML. So tiny ML is that the form factor is very small, in which we'll implement our the code. Okay, the machine learning code, which is taking too much memory, tiny ML will convert into small. I mean, we'll reduce the size, and after that, we'll install in the small microcontroller like your Arduino Nano BLE sensor. So this will be the flow of talk, in which I will discuss about how data is clustering, pre-processing this one, deep preparation of deep learning model. Then I will introduce the optimization, how you can optimize the deep learning model, okay, using pruning, quantization, clustering. Then we'll see. So first here, I'm going to discuss about two things. One is what is human activity recognition, different kind of gesture. Second, how you can collect the data through this hardware. Third, that how you can fuse this data over this microcontroller. And second thing, how we'll use these machine learning algorithm, which actually running in the large computer. Okay, how we can easily fuse this data over microcontroller with limited memory, limited power consumption, limited capabilities. Okay, so machine learning or microcontroller is the most efficient, cheap and reliable way of developing edge computing applications. So here I'm introducing one terminology, that is edge computation application. So when machine learning algorithms are converted in a such a way so that we can run on the microcontroller, so it is becoming cheap as well as reliable, and we require very less energy consumption. Okay, and microcontroller, if you consider Arduino Nano 33, it has only 256 MB flash memory. Okay, so we require to reduce the size so that we can fuse over this microcontroller. So in this research, I consider this Arduino Nano 33 BLE cells. The name itself telling many things. Arduino is the name of this microcontroller board. Nano is that form factor is very small. 33 is that 3.3 volt is the input voltage. BLE is the name of the Bluetooth. And the sense is, it is having 9 sensors. So in this way, this board is very fruitful. Recently, I also fused code over this one. And this board will, this microcontroller will use to capture the data of different gestures. So like for this research, I consider 5 gestures: squat, jump, walk, run, and rest other activities. So these are considered gesture. Morning also I saw, and even I have made publicly available data set. You can easily download the data set from my website. You can see. Okay, sorry sir, I have not shared screen, I think. Okay, now maybe you are able to visualize this one. So it is available gate data set I made available here. Here you can see that data set of different activities, CSV formatted also I made. Okay, that is actually this data set you can download. You can apply some deep learning model and perform the classification. Okay, all sort of things is given, how data is collected through Arduino boards, different activities like brisk walk, normal walk, very slow, these 6. So this is the data set. Then the activity name is written, walk on toe, and there is accelerometer data, XY, that I will show later on what is this data. So I started my presentation here. Maybe you have not seen my PPT. Okay, so in this I was discussing about tiny ML, how you can design the small machine learning model so that you can fuse over microcontroller. Okay, these were the outlines, okay, which I will refer one by one. So I was discussing this one. We are trying to design machine learning to enable to fuse in the microcontroller. Then I consider the 5 gestures: square, jump, walk, run, and rest other. So SAM board I'm using for the capturing that data because it is enabled with the sensor, and SAM board I will use to fuse the code after learning deep learning model, same deep learning model I will fuse over this microcontroller. So the board has capabilities such as embedded sensor and the BLE enabled. Okay. We'll build the deep learning model using capture gesture data to classify the human gestures. Okay, so this is what microcontroller Arduino Nano 33 BLE sensor. Okay, so it has 9 sensors. The sensor name are IMU, 9-axis IMU, inertia measurement sensor, which is having 3-axis for accelerometer, XYZ, 3-axis for gyroscope, again XYZ. So accelerometer is AX, EY, AZ, acceleration, gyroscope GX, GY, GZ, and magnetometer MX, MX, Y, and MG. What are the units that I will discuss after this? Apart from that, there is another sensor. That is your proximity sensor. Light color gesture sensors is there. So this is another sensor. The second sensor is temperature and humidity sensor, which is here. Then power LED is also here to provide. Then USB port is there to microcontroller USB port. And it has, this is your Bluetooth device. Okay, it is supporting RF52 processor with the Nina Bluetooth module. Okay, this is the RGB programmable LED, which can run on different program. RGB color, you can produce any sort of RGB color. And this is microphone also, you can apply for speech recognition also. And there is pressure sensor also. So SAM board can be utilized for these 9 category of sensors. Okay, you can fuse your data over here. Let us see the specification of this micro Arduino Nano. The tiny form factor is that it is just 45 into 18 millimeter dimension. That's why it is tiny. And it has 9 onboard sensor. In this research, accelerometer and gyroscope inertia sensor are used, which is inbuilt inside the IMU. Okay, so it has 32-bit ARM Cortex-M4 CPU. V306 module for Bluetooth. The static RAM is 256 KB plus memory 1 megabyte and operating voltage is 3.3 voltage required. So you require converter also. This can convert 5 volt into 3.3 general laptop. So this is the specification, very small. You can see that I already shown you this one in morning session. Very small. So the benefit of this one, you can easily wear also. This much of a small sensor is there. You can easily wear. You can place over your any wearable suit you can design. And you can place on the both leg, left and right leg. So you can utilize this one. Okay. The goal is here, why we are going for this Arduino Nano BLE. We want to enable this edge computing. The application of edge computing, if we are able to fuse our computer program over microcontroller chip, so we can take the development benefit of low energy consumption as well as low computing. We can perform same task. So to say the benefit of developing edge computer application without sacrificing the accuracy. So when you are reducing your network or model, deep learning model, we are not losing any significant classification accuracy of these different activities. Okay, ultimately my target to classify these activities like jump, run, squat, walk, also. And our target to fuse over this Arduino Nano 33 BLE sensor board, which is cost effective, low energy consumption, data privacy is there. The form factor is tiny, which already I showed, 45 into 118 mm. And it is flexible, you can take anywhere, you can. Now the challenges are coming before formulating the problem. First, capturing training data from Arduino board. So we require Python script, which already available is there, that I will share also GitHub link from where you can do. Second thing, the size of traditional machine learning model is huge, or deep learning model. Loading the model onto the microcontroller is challenging. For this, we have to do for pruning, clustering, and optimization techniques will apply to reduce the model size. So this is the methodology how we'll work for data collection. First, we are starting. We'll place this one on the human body. Then we'll apply on, we'll collect the data. Okay, after collecting data, we'll build the deep learning model in computer and we'll try to classify these gestures. Once it is done, then once model is prepared, I need to optimize that model so that I can fuse over microcontroller. But in between, I need to identify different gestures like jump, run. So I will use LED color, different color LED. For one gesture, I will designate it one particular gesture like red for run, green for jump, yellow for this one. So this way, if you wear and you are performing jump, so that time your red color is blinking. That means it is correctly identifying your activities. Okay. And here I will calculate the probabilities. Okay, the probability, because the deep learning model will use some softmax function that I will discuss later. Okay, so now let us start with data collection field. Here the board is programmed to capture the 3-axis accelerometer and 3-axis gyroscope using the inertia measurement sensor IMU, because already there is IMU sensor available here. This IMU sensor, which have an accelerometer, gyroscope and accelerometer. So I'm using this one. The accelerometer is generally taking acceleration around x, y, z axis. This is your x, this is your y, this is your z axis. Acceleration around x, y, z axis. So generally meter per second square. So I'm using in g-force. G-force is specially 9.8 meter per second square. So minus 4g to plus 4g in meter per second square, you just need to multiply by 9.8. But it is changing with the, if you are moving from Earth to Moon, then G will change. And this is this much deviation allow, plus or minus this. Gyroscope will give rotation around X axis, Y axis, and Z axis. Rotation. And it is giving round per second. Okay, so minus 2000 to plus 2000, round per second, and then plus or minus 40. That is variation allow. Magnetometer is coming micro Tesla, minus 400 to plus 400, and that is deviation allow. The, for our research purpose, we have taken different sampling rates. So I'm a sampling rate, we have considered 10 hertz, 50 hertz, 119 hertz, 238. So especially in this research for which I calculated that time, I've considered 119 hertz frequency sampling. That means in one sample, I consider 119 data row for one sample. And I collected 6 angles. Each gesture is performed 100 times. So total data will become, in one sample, I have 119 row. And each time we have performed 100 times. So it is going becoming now 100 into 119. And the minimum threshold is 1.5. Okay, so I can show that which kind of data we are getting. That is available with me. You can go, I'm sharing with you. You can also visualize. I'm sharing with everyone. This is here, that code you can download. Okay, from here you can come here. Okay. So this is my code which I'm created. And the data side is here. Data, if you'll go in TinyML, TinyMS. The data you can see from source, SRC, okay. Source data. So 5 gesture I consider, jump, run, square, walk, and other activity. Now you can see the data nature, which kind of data is there. This kind of data you will get. This is acceleration around x-axis. Why these 3 reading you are getting from accelerometer, these 3 reading you are getting from gyroscope. So acceleration around x-axis, y-axis, these are the readings you are getting. Okay, so one sample I have how many rows? 119 rows. Okay, and I consider this is for 100 sample. That means 100 time I perform this activity. So we are getting 11900 total, 100 into 119. This is your data size for one particular gesture. Okay, then you have another gesture run, squared, same data set you will get. So nature is clear. Accelerometer data and gyroscope data. This is numerical data you are getting. Then I plotted these curves. I found like for one nine sample, for one sample I plotted accelerometer data and gyroscope around XY. I'm getting this one for each question square. Then I plotted for entire Hendra sample, 12,000 to almost 11900. So this one. Then another activities, jump, I'm getting such kind of curve. For one sample, multiple sample, one sample, multiple sample, all five guesses I have answered. Now this is for running whole sample, gyroscope accelerometer, and this is for last activity. After that, I prepared some pre-processing I have done that I will discuss now. Similar data I have used also in my file, in which I consider 9 data. Similar AX, AY, AZ, GX, UY, Z, magnitude. This is 9 degree accelerometer data I consider, and here we have more varieties. Here I am considering almost 10 gestures. Okay. Jogging, 10 gestures I have considered. Jogging is there. Walk on hill. Downstairs, upstairs, ramp-up, ramp-down, you are walking in the normal walk and this, all sort of things, you can download from my website, this data. You can build your model. So five gestures, each having 100 samples, each sample having 119 theta. Sampling frequency is this one. Okay, then once data is classified using deep learning model, what we'll do? We'll transfer this data, capture data from this BLE sensor to our computer or any device, hard disk, wherever we want to store this data. Then Python script to discover the BLE device and establish the connection using the GATT service that is there. For a gesture, data is sent continuously until all sample are read, and data is sent from string. So you can see that this is now BLE connected. It is showing the indicator color, and this data I am receiving AX, AY, AZ, AGX, and you can easily store in the which one? Excel sheet. You can open Arduino board. Arduino BLE. If it will work, here you can easily read the data. So by Arduino reading, you can easily read the data. The code you can write in C language or Python. I've written in C to capture this data. So this is like this board. From here you can select which board is you are going to select, Arduino Nano. Port also you can submit, otherwise board is here. Okay, board manager. You can install also, you can search here. Arduino Nano 33 BLE set. So you will get, you can easily install it here. Okay. This is here, you can install from here. And once it is installed, you just need to select which board you are using. Arduino Nano port is there. Okay. And then finally you can check some example, basic example. You can write your code here. You can write the code so that you can store into the Excel sheet or CSV file. After once data is stored for five activities, then I need to prepare this data what we have stored in our computer. Now I need to classify this data using deep learning model. So data pre-processing, I have divided data into three portions, training portion, validation portion, and test portion. So 70% of data I consider for training, 50% I consider validation, and 50% for testing purpose. Okay. So 70% data out of this one I consider for training. Then I fitted the deep learning model using training data, and to fuse into my microcontroller, I have applied this optimization tool. So what I've done, I have applied pruning and the quantization on this model. Okay, so pruning quantization, what will help me to reduce the size of my model. Okay, once it is done, then quantized model is there, and then directly we are wearing this Arduino Nano board, and it is able to classify my activity. And we have significant amount of performance. There is no significant difference between before pruning or after pruning of models that I will show. Okay. So how data pre-processing happen? Before preparing the deep learning model, we know that our input size is 6x11904 1 guess cell. Similarly, you have 5 guess cells. So first, let us create the tensor of this matrix. So as I know that we have 6 guess, 5 guessers, each guesser has 119 sample. So I'm considering one sample of each guesser. So total you have 716 guessers, 716 row. And you have each guesser having 100 samples. So I've considered 5 guesses. We have total 500 samples. So how 500 sample guess, 100 sample for each of the 5 guessers. And so each sample rate is this one. Acceleration is 119 into 6. That's why you are getting 11716 sample. Okay. So these are becoming your features. Your first input matrix will be 716 into 500. 716 into 500, that is your first matrix. It is your input. So first input will be 716, then you will have one hidden layer, second hidden layer, third hidden layer. 1 minute, I have received one call. Okay, sorry for delay. So actually your input is becoming now 500x716. So 716 is number of feature, 500 total rows are there. And then what you will do, transform output also, because output is for testing time. This is for training, this is for testing time. So testing time only you are considering 50% of data. So you are considering 500 for each sample and 5 guesses you are considering. So output is what? You have 5 guesses. So I will convert into one hot encoding, like guesser 1 is 1000, guesser 2 is 0100, guesser 3 is 0010. This way I am placing the data. So if I will transform this data, it will come like this. If I can show you. You can see data after transforming this data input before learning model as one hot encoding I have done. So its first guesser is becoming 100. The first 100 row will having this 10 vector 100. Second 100 will be 0110. Third 100 will be this way I have applied these vectors. Then what I have done, I have split it into 60% for training, 20% for test and 20% for validation. This way I have done. Then I have trained the neural network model. So I am achieving almost 74. This accuracy, you can see that after 700 iteration, I have achieved accuracy almost 96. And the validation loss is 0.02 and value accuracy is 91. Okay. Then this is the network parameter which I have used. The loss function is there after 700 iteration. It is almost 0.7. And this is for prediction, which I done for testing samples. Okay, after that, what I have done? This is my confusion matrix for 5 clusters. I am getting classification. Okay. Now I need to convert into the light version. So TensorFlow Lite. For this, I have used converter of TF Lite or TensorFlow. And same model which I have used here, store model that I pass here, it is converted into light model. Okay. Then I try to apply pruning. So what is pruning? That also I will discuss. What is quantization? What is clustering? That also I will discuss. But my object is that after pruning, we have not lost significance loss. Still, we are getting 96% of accuracy. Here also, almost 97. Better accuracy we are getting. Okay, pruning. Then quantization. So shuffle input and output data so that there will be variety of things. So we have split into 60 training, 20 test, and 20 validation. We have used deep learning model, deep sense network, feed forward network with hidden layers, 4 hidden layer, 3 hidden layer, 1 input layer, 1 output layer. Input layer, you have 750 neurons. First hidden layer, you have 100, second hidden layer, 75, third hidden 70, and finally, you have 5 guesser. So output is only 5. And we have considered dropout also. And dropout is similar concept in which you try to reduce the network by removing some neurons. Okay, so 0.5. In 15% of out of 75, 15 neurons you are going to deactivate. Either out of 100, 85 neurons are working, 15 neurons you are killing. Okay, so I'm not going how ReLU is there because it requires a little bit understanding of deep learning. So total number of parameter we have 85,150. Because what happened? We have initially 715 into 100, this much of weight. Then second is 100 into 75. 75, 75, then 75 into 75, 57. This way we have total number of parameters. Okay. For executing this code, we have used some parameter. Adam for optimization with learning rate, mean square error function I have used. We have tried for cost, entropy loss, and accuracy we have considered for models. Okay. So now let us enter to optimize model. We are using pruning, quantization, and clustering. So what happening in dropout, certain layers we are removing, like some neurons I will remove. But what is the logic for removing this neuron? So in dropout, simply randomly we used to remove some neurons. Okay, randomly, if 50% of neuron I have to reduce, so out of 4 neuron at particular layer, I have reduced 2 neurons and only 2 neuron are there. But in case of pruning, I am removing only those neurons for which I am getting very minimum weight, less weight. Okay, so higher weight I'm keeping, low weight I'm simply removing. So pruning is more better compared to the dropout. Dropout, simply randomly I'm removing some neurons. Okay, to reduce the power. Okay, so reduce model size, these are faster executed and reduce power consumption, and they are also giving same performance. Pruning is the iterative process on the trained model that time insignificant weight by the setting those weight to zero. So the insignificant weight I am setting zero. If it is lowest weight, I am setting zero. And ReLU activation function will work like this. Yeah, hello. 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 Ha, ma'am. Ha, hello. Okay, sorry. So what happening in pruning? I was discussing. some node I am removing, and this is like ReLU activation function. So ReLU is working like this. For negative value, it is zero. For positive value, it is equation of line y equal to x. Okay. So for which neuron I have to deactivate it, we have to make it linear zero. Otherwise, it is linear function. Okay. If they are telling that lowest weight, we are considering zero, and only these. So if it is zero, these neurons will not work. The neuron will die and network size will remove. Okay. So as it is happening, some weights we are removing. Here we are not removing neurons. Here we are just removing weights. Okay, weight, least significant. But in dropout, what is happening? We are removing the neurons. Okay. So just it is compressed version, optimized version, which is as accurate as previous one. Okay. Another is quantization. So quantization, it is very much related to JPG compression. Is a process where the weight are converted to low precision types, such as from floating 20 to integer 8. Okay, precision. We are not bothered for double, like double to float you are converting, or float to integer 8 you are converting. That is what different quantization. It's a process from to convert weight. One is that lower weight we have removed. Another thing that quantization, in which we are removing this storage size also we are trying to reduce. So how it works? Take only the required range used by the floating 32 to represent in the smaller number of bit. Second, that the histogram distribution of value in particular tensor by grouping data into 25 bins. Okay, so it's coming like Gaussian distribution. Okay, I am considering it is coming -127 to +127, maybe 2 raised to power. If you see the 2's complementary representation, we can go -2 raised to power n -1 to 2 raised to power n -1 -1. Okay, so it is coming like that. So if it is 8 to 2 raised to power 7 in -127, so 7-bit or 8-bit representation is there. Okay, so whatever range of your floating point -3 into 10 raised to power 38, I am just converting into a small range. Okay, integer 8-bit I am considering with this end, and all data is going to be merged here. So histogram distribution of value in the particular tensor by grouping data into 255, which is integer, and quantization value is how we are doing. Whatever floating value is there, divide by scale. Scale is what? Min minus max, and then 0 points. In this way, you can easily convert the So this is what quantized values you are getting. There is what scale factor, min minus max upon 2 raised to power n, floating points. This is mathematically you can easily understand. So two things we have applied. One is pruning, low weight matrix, low weights I have removed. Neuron I am not removed, but weight I have removed, some weights which I am low weight. Second is that quantization, in which we try to convert all floating point value into integer 8. That means we are not going for high precision, we are going for low precision. Then after applying this one, the network size will decrease. Okay, the board is programmed to use 10 TensorFlow Lite for model. There is directly TensorFlow Lite model available, with this you can classify these gestures. Okay, so now what is happening, you have 5 gestures you will get at output layer. You have how many neurons? 5 neurons are at output layers. 5 neurons we are counting at output layer. Five neurons are there output layer, by which what I am trying to do, five probability I will get, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, I will get probability distribution like 0.4, 0.1, 0.1, 0.2, 0.2. Whichever highest probability, 1. That means this gesture is belonging to guesser 1. Okay, and the sum of probabilities 0.4 plus 1 plus 1 plus 2 is 1. So this is perfect probability distribution. The highest probability I'm getting for 1. So my guesser is belonging to category 1. Okay, so that is what it is doing. Highest probability guesser indicated by LED. So each guesser I'm assigning some LED light, like squared, you are having red light. Jump, you are going magenta. Walk, you are getting blue. Run, you are getting green. Another, you are getting white. So based on these light, you can easily classify once it is data view. You can wear, you can see. Okay. So as I'm getting gesture is square, the probability is 0.984 and time it took 8 seconds. So what is happening? Result, you can see this already I saw for one sample squared accelerometer XYZ data and gyroscope data is there. This I plotted for 100 samples, simple for jump, 100 samples, walk. This much of sample data is here. This I already shown you, the sample validation error. So validation error, if you see that loss is almost going to become the zero. After 7 and validation, it is 0.02. So training and validation error, both are going to reduce. And the accuracy is almost, we are getting 96% out after this, both validation. So confusion matrix for before completion. Square, jump, walk and run. So out of 20 out of 20, this is for a square, it is classified as square. Jump, 16 classified, 3 misclassified, it is classified as walk. Walk, 28 perfectly classified. In case of run, 12 is classified as run and 1 is classified as other activity. In other, we are getting all other is 90. So almost only 3 plus 1 is misclassification. Okay. After pruning, this is before pruning, after pruning. So size, accuracy and confusion matrix of the compressed model. The size of the model is reduced by 4 times from 2.1 MB to 0.5 MB and the accuracy retained the same. You see that still we have good accuracy, only 3 misclassification here, 2 plus 1. So from here I have proved that the compressed model is as efficient as it was before. The size is same, accuracy same. We have not lost significant accuracy, but we have implemented TinyML. Now what is happening that girls is wearing that IMU sensor at lab. And it is giving white because this is squared. So whatever activity you will perform, it will give that color of this one. In this case, when you are moving, then different blue color LEDs blinking, green, different gesture. So in this way, you can easily see the gestures. Okay. So from here, I would like to conclude this section. The researcher show that how simple and efficient it is achieved to end to end in this S computing. Using deep learning prediction for human gesture real data. So as computing, when we are enabling the microcontroller to execute this one, gesture application showcase all the benefits the microcontroller offer to mention in the go. Along with benefit, the tiny form factor and embedded sensor can be used as a wearable device and therefore used in the building multiple real world application. It is not only for the human gait activity recognition, human activity, it is only to track the human being also. Okay. The other reference is this one. Now I will come on discussion of the gait. And let us see the application with respect to the robotics. So let us understand what is locomotion. Already from one. So locomotion is the walk of bipedal robot with the help of two limbs, left and right limb. It is walking in a forward direction. So this is swing phase, when one foot is in the air, this is swing phase and stance phase. Now, alternately, one foot is coming in the air, another is coming on the ground. So one foot is in the air, another is in the ground. So the foot which is in the air is in the swing phase. Swing phase is here. Okay. Now, another important behavior is post recovery. Post applying some external force from behind. human being and human being is able to recall. So these are the two essential behavior which one human being must pose or one bipedal robot must pose to work in human unit. So I discuss about how we can capture through human being. We try to analyze human being behavior. Now how we can apply in the robot these things. So why I'm discussing this locomotion of posture, because the robot are bipedal and they are supposed to work in, like you can see that these are the bipedal robots, okay, and they are supposed to work in human environments, like they are climbing staircase, down staircase, ramp, they are playing soccer game, they are playing with the human. So all sort of time they are supposed to receive some external force, as well as they require the capability which is very similar to human being walk. That's why we are concentrating here. And the bipedal robot require these two essential behavior, walking as well as push recovery. So yes, I written sub points why we are interested for bipedal, why push recovery, and what we expect from bipedal. The bipedal is the robot which having two legs, which is very similar to human being, which can walk in the any environment. But so far robot is walk in the laboratory environment, they cannot walk like us robustly in any kind of terrain. So the motivation is 4D environment, dull, dirty, dangerous and difficult environment. Dull environment, repetitively tasks, human being will get tired, but robot can do this task. Human has constructed entire infrastructure for two leg animals, that's why bipedal robot is required. Second thing, that the robot help us to for space exploration. They can go for mining purpose where harmful gas are coming. It can help many time to save the life of people, because if human will go, harmful gases are coming, maybe it can lead for casualty and all. The comparison of bipedal with the four leg animal, the four leg animal is not that much agility, as you can jump very efficiently any canal. Four leg animal used to find it very difficult. So the bipedal is very dexterity. We can easily negotiate the obstacle also. If any obstacle or stone is coming in front of our path, we can jump. Okay, we can step also over uneven terrain. We can walk in any sort of things. Okay, again the walking is reflexive behavior, which I discussed this morning, and it's take almost a year to learn this behavior. Okay, the benefit we can use and help the elderly people, assist the elderly people to replace human during war, help the amputee people to recover their walking. Okay, biometric identification also we can use. Okay, so you can see that what is post recovery behavior. When the robot has no capability of post recovery, so here you can see what happening. The robot is walking, the ball is coming and colliding with it, and robot was unable to recover. So what will happen in this case? Unmanned environment, robot will get fall, and our purpose will not solve why we are developing the robot. So we require post recovery capability. For this, we have designed this kind of ankle strategy in which the ball is coming with the same magnitude, at this time the robot was able to walk. So that was the motivation why we require post recovery. So there is basically three kind of post recovery capabilities. One is when force is small, little bit medium force, and very large magnitude of force. What will happen? Each time you will use different negotiation capabilities. When force is small, we are using just torque against ankle. When force is more, we are using ankle and hip. When it is more, then you are taking stepping also. Okay, so for mathematically analyzing purpose, what will you use? Make that such models, so that I'm not going to discuss here. Okay, so now I'm coming on the gait cycle. What is gait cycle? This is one complete gait cycle. It is starting with the heel contact of left foot, and again it is finishing with the when same foot is contacting on the ground. So it's a three-step process. The right initial contact to right initial contest. When SAM foot is coming on the ground, that we consider one gate complete cycle, and you used to repeat that gear cycle again and again. So gear cycle is the time between successive foot contact of the SAM limbs. Thus, one gear cycle become when the reference foot contact the ground and end with the subsequent for the contact at the SAM foot. Generally, gait you can see from the different planes. There are the entire human body you can divide into three planes. One is sagittal plane, another is coronal plane or frontal plane, and third is traversal. So generally, we used to see that sagittal plane. Sagittal plane used to divide entire human body into left and right portion. So we can easily visualize from this direction to the robot walk, and you can see hip, knee, ankle easily, and this is strategy for hip joints. As I discussed morning, hip joint I am getting sinusoidal. This is for one gait cycle. Okay, for knee joint I am getting big hump, small hump, and for ankle joint I am getting small hump and big hump. Okay, the thing is that both are inversely related. Knee and ankle joint are inversely related. Okay, so when there is high, how it is there? When your heel is striking on ground, this ankle is striking on ground, the knee joint is going to lock. And when it is in here, knee joint is highly activated. So that's why you heard about knee replacement is required, because knee joint is highly activated joints compared to hip, knee, and ankle. So when your heel is striking on the ground, then highest torque at the ankle, least torque at the knee. When you are moving, you are bending your knee, highest torque in the knee, but least torque in the ankle. So there are different kind of walks, static walk and dynamic walk. Static walk, when we are standing and the center of mass projection is falling on the ground within this support polygon, then it is static walk. And dynamic walk, when we are playing something like playing soccer, badminton, any other game, that time what is happening, the position of center of mass, okay, is falling outside of this region. But momentarily we are unstable. Once you place this leg again on ground, this leg, the center of mass will go through this support polygon. So that's why dynamic and static walk, both are stable walk, but dynamic walk is more challenging. Okay, this already I discussed, entire gait cycle is one healthy person can complete within 1 second, less than 1 second, within 0.5 to second or 52 millisecond, you can finish this one. And these are the different subphases. Where configuration of gait is, this is loading response, mid stance, terminal stance, pre swing, initial swing, mid swing, and turn. These are the terminology which we are using. Bipedal robot, locomotion walk. Okay, so there are some robots. I will show that how I capture the human being data. Okay, then I will come back again here. So that initially I was using this device to capture the human being data through the mobile phone. Okay, this is passive walker I designed. So what is happening in this case, the sensor, accelerometer sensor is placed on the ankle, mobile phone, which is enabled with the accelerometer, and the person is, subject is walking, and I'm capturing data, both leg we have captured. We have just tied the things. That is accelerometer data, okay? Another technique also we have used. In this case, what is happening? We have placed six wearable sensor on the six joint, hip, knee, ankle of left and right leg. Then Arduino board we have connected here. This is your Arduino board. And then we have asked to move the person. This is wired one. Now I have wireless everything. And this was initial setup, which my MTech students are doing. There are potentiometer applied on the six joints to track the position. Now these readings I'm getting, this reading I can plot throughout in a board. So these are the readings you will get. Okay. So two way I have used, same thing I've utilized to capture the push recovery data. So in this case, what is happening, push recovery, I'm applying some force for behind. I've used force sensor at the back of that girl. And we have applied different magnitude of force. Some wearable dress we have used. Okay, so the force we are applying from behind, different magnitude, little bit small. So we are using different study, ankle, hip, and stepping. If magnitude is less, we are applying only ankle study. If it is more, we are involving hip and ankle. And if it is more. In this case, we have closed eyes because robot cannot see from which direction force is coming. And again, it is wired. The Arduino board, all sensors are connected with Arduino board and they are connected with this computer. We are recording the data. Okay. Another things with learning, we have bind the hand also because hand movement also helping us to recover and we are interested in only lower extremity. So in this case, what is happening? The force we are applying of different magnitude and we are trying to see how long we are able to sustain. So we found some interesting results from here, observation that if you are left-handed person, your right foot is coming front. If you are right-handed person, your left foot is coming. That means if you are left-handed person, your right brain is highly activated. If you are right-handed person, your left brain is more activated. Okay. It doesn't mean that your right brain will be not activated. Both brain will be activated, but left and right will be more activated in case of their hand movement. Second thing that it depends on various factors, highly non-linear like age, weight, gender, whether it is athlete or normal human being. So very high level. Gait is very variable things. It is changing. It is not that much permanent like other biometric traits. But gait, we don't require to take the permission of there if you are recording through the camera, we can directly capture. Okay, so for any biometric identification, it should be very unique. It should be available with every human being. Okay, and it should be permanent. It is not that day by day it is changing or yearly it is changing. At least it should work for 5 years. Okay, 5 to 10 years, like your fingerprint and other. Now I'm coming back on my discussion, which I'm going to do. Same thing you can apply on robot. There is different kind of robot. One is zero movement point, another is foot placement capability based robot, another is passive walker and hybrid zero dynamics walker. So you can see also the human being highly energy efficient as well as they have high agilities. Okay, we want to construct the robot which can have this factor. As agility is increasing, you can see that big dog, we are losing the energy efficient cost. You can see that Kandar robot, this is passive walker, it is high energy efficient, but it can perform only one sort of work. It has participated in the marathon and almost one battery, it has covered 64 kilometers and it won also. This is the robot is coming, Kandar robot by Boston Dynamics. It won the marathon. But it has no knee. Finally, it won the marathon. So the beauty of this one, it is minimum activation, only 2.5 push and the leg swim was there. No other actuation was there. There was no knee joints. With the single battery, it covered almost 63 kilometer. The limitation was that the negative point is that it can perform only one kind of gait or only one kind of walk with the one speed. It is not like that we started running, walking and all. It cannot clear the obstacle also. In 2011, they have developed this corner robot. This is passive walker. Then ZMP based robot, that is Asimo robot, Honda Asimo now robot. It can perform different gestures, waving hand, jumping, running, dancing, all sort of things it can do. It can serve in the hospitality industry to serve the human being. Running it started. It is playing soccer also. It can climb over a staircase flat, but we are calculating zero movement point on the ground first, then we are moving forward. It is serving in the hospitality industry also. That is another category of robot, that is Hope 2 robot. I will show each robot one by one. The another robot is Big Dog. It is barely energy, but it is quadruple, 4 lakh. It used developed by Boston Dynamics. It used to carry the luggage for the US Army military. And it is having push recovery capability, very sophisticated. It can walk in different terrain, slippery, hilly station, everywhere it can walk. You see that slippery surface and push recovery capability, how intelligently it has recovered, better than human being. It used to carry some luggage or weapon to the Army at the hill station like CHN and some other water. It is walking over slippery surface. So how sophisticated they have designed. Each year Boston Dynamics is coming with a new robot. Now recently Boston Dynamics has this robot. It having image vision capabilities. It is following some bookmarks and following these bookmarks or color, and it is moving ahead and then walking over different surface. It can pick the object also, okay, and place here pre-recorded trajectory. It is identifying the object and picking and placing these objects from one place to another place. Okay. Now what is happening? The object is shifting its location. Again, based on these bookmarks, these diagrams, it is following the objects. The target is shifted. What will happen? Robot will also move. Is behaving like human being. It is not picking any object anywhere. First it is sensing. If sensing, then it is finding image and this one. It having self recovery capabilities. Automatically it is recovering and start walking. Okay, so this is post recovery. Elbow. This is your Atlas Part 2, that is more sophisticated one and more intelligent and more capable. It can perform squat better than human being. You can see that how efficiently he has done this job. Okay. Now I'm coming, how you can design the robot similar to human. So human anatomy is given here. We have hip, knee and ankle. So similar, we have designed the mathematical or link architecture, which is very similar to human leg. These are the points which we used to refer during the walk, center of pressure, center movement point, all sort of things. You can see that what is happening. This is ground reaction force. Passing through central mass, it is stable, but when it is passing through outside problem, it is supposed to pass here. So you have to move it. That's why we used to fall. We used to fall only due to this region. It is possible that you can get different sort of terrain or ground, level ground, inclined ground, staircase, ramp, uneven ground. Okay, so that's why it is applicable for different age groups. Okay, now let us read the parameter of gait. You have step length and you have stride length. Step, you have left step length, right step length. So you have, it is distance between successive foot contact of left and right leg. Okay, so that is step length and stride length. Stride length is always 2 times of step length. Then one gait cycle, already I told that it is 3 steps. Left step, right step, left step. That means when same foot will contact it on the ground, then it is considered one gait cycle. Then for this, you have to understand what is swing phase and stance phase. And for one leg, I am going to represent. If you see the swing phase, this is your swing phase. Your foot is in the air. This is your stance phase. Foot is in the ground. Swing phase, stance phase. But we have to go for both left and right. So you see that when left foot is in the swing phase, right foot is in the stance phase. When right foot is in the swing phase, left foot is in the stance phase. Okay, so stance phase is at straight line, swing phase is when your curve is moving in upward direction. Okay, so other thing you can see that there is 3 steps. This is your 1 step length, swing and stance. That's why we used to consider one gait cycle. Okay, and stride length is 2 step length. This is your left step, this is your left step length, this is your right step length, and the combination is stride length. So already I shown you these diagrams, how you capture the data. Already I shown you morning, capture the data for this one. This also I discuss. Now this is the kinase sensor which I have used for my experimental purpose, and this is provided by the Microsoft. Okay, it is using for speech as well as gesture recognition. You have different sensors like vision sensor, you have LED sensor, you have depth sensor, you have micro array, microphone array, you have motorized unit. A 3D depth sensor has used, and for 15 subjects we have captured the data for different activity, nature walk, walking very slow, walking slow, walking medium, walking fast, walking on go, walking on hill, stair, almost 10 gestures we have considered. Okay, we have captured data through both IMU sensor as well as kinase sensor. Okay, this already I discussed. This paper also I discussed in the morning. Okay. Then I implemented this hybrid automata model, though I will not discuss this one, but briefly I will tell about what is this model, hybrid automata model. So any system which has continuous dynamic as well as discrete switching logic, that place hybrid automata kind of model will work. Okay. We have designed hybrid automata for all the 8 phases, initial conformation, mid-stance, terminal stance, pre-swing, initial swing, all sorts of things. We have generated the TJT. We have compared TJT and TJT almost coming very similar to the original work. So we can validate our hypothesis correct. Okay. And we have applied this model, if you can see here. The model is not able to work because there was no motion file. After that, I provided motion file and the model was able to work. And you can see that red color is hip joints and blue is your knee joints. Red is almost coming sinusoidal, blue is coming one humpy hump, and that is one gait cycle data. Okay. So I'm directly coming on the last section of this presentation. That is your gait cycle presentation. Okay. So gait is using in surveillance, communication, biometric surveillance. It can work on the low resolution also from distance. We can easily capture. It is very difficult to come up low. Okay, you cannot hide the gait also. And it is captured without worker attention, even though we don't need to take the permission of worker how to do it. Then communication. Yes, sir. Hello. Sir, can we move at 4 na? 4. Okay, sir. I will come. Na, sir. Okay, sir. Okay. Sure, sir. Okay, sir. Yeah. Okay, sure. Okay, sure. Okay. And then there is communication is here. Okay, sir. So information, gesture, emotion, which already I told you that human activity recognition and biometric also we are using, where you have to identify the person uniquely, their gestures. Okay. So surveillance, you can apply airport security, corridor walk, recognition of person through the gaze, human computer interaction through the gait analysis. These are the application. Challenge is that it is very difficult to find the features. This is not given. Style of walking, human profile, there is speed of walking. Okay, these are the challenges associated. High degree of freedom because human body is more joint, so they have more degree of freedoms. Okay, so these are the points which occlusion when multiple people are walking, one gait is preserving another one. Okay, so these are the contexts where we have applied this one. We can go for corridor walk, camera fix, multiple subjects. Occlusion or situation we are supposed. So this is like when multiple people are walking, they are hiding one another. So this is occlusion sequence. Okay. So gait is the style of walking. The gait dynamics involve the frame cycle of this one and the configuration of shape of the people perform the gaits. So these are the topics which further interest of study, which already I discussed with you. Okay, so how you can design this gait recognition model? So that is first we have extracted the feature, then you have identified the gait cycle, and then you have completed the gait feature and prepared the data set. After that, for testing, if it is video based, you will again extract the features, you will again extract the gait cycle, and after that you will compare the feature, and that model will help you to classify the gait. So there is two approach for gait recognition. One is model based approach, another is motion based. So model based approach, we are not focused, we are focusing on motion based approach, in which we are further applying state space method, spatial temporal method. This kind of approach you can do. So you can get OCR data set. I am showing you data set from where you can get all sort of data. Osaka University. I have Duncan person data also. From here you can download the data set. So there is 1, 2, 3, 4 data set is given. You can go for like biometric data set or inertia sensor data set. Here they are using inertia sensor placing on these points. You can get these things. There is different work files are there. These are AX, AY, AZ, GX, six column. So at least you can implement this one. This also I'm sharing with you. You can have multiple people when crowded places you are working. That time also you can use. Okay. So what I will do, I will from my end, I have covered this portion. You can go for multi-view angle when you are taking from different camera angles, 90 degrees, 75, 60 degrees. So you have to design such a robust algo which is view invariant, which is cloth invariant, which is speed invariant. You can go for computer vision as well as large population, crowded person like bus stand anywhere. Okay. With the different carrying, if you are carrying some suitcase or other, that time also it is becoming difficult. So now what I will do, I finish from my end. You can read here. I share the data set and I'm sharing this TinyOS data set also for your reference. You can work on this one. Otherwise you can mail me also. And now what I will see that you can ask question and answer if any question with you, I will be happy to answer. So with this, I will finish here my talk. And if any question answer, I can take. Data set already I see here, GitHub code already I see here. So let us conclude the things. I started human activity recognition. Morning I discuss about how gate can be utilized for human health monitoring. Gate can be recorded using the six joint angle, hip, knee and ankle of left and right hand. It's a very complex behavior. It's a learning process which human baby used to learn. Once you have learned, then you don't need to think about how you are walking till you are not at dangerous terrain. Okay. So this way we have started our journey. After that, we have considered gait recording techniques by IMU as well as kinesis sensor, which I had. Then we have explored data set. Second half, I discussed about human activity recognition for five gestures. Then we have explored how deep learning model can be applied and how you can convert using quantization and pruning so that we can get optimized model. Okay. So with this, I will finish here and I will open the question answer. If you have any question answer, you can ask. Otherwise, you can mail also me. I have written my mail ID here. Yeah.
Okay.
Sir, yes.
Now it's a time to ask the question.
Yeah.
If anyone has the question, please ask the question. Or else you can write the question in chat box if you are having any difficulty with.
Correct.
I think no one has the question.
Yes, sir. Box.
No. Chat box also, there is no question.
No, sir. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, sir. In that case, we will conclude this here. Akshay Jadhav, sir, are you there? Akshay Jadhav, sir.
Yes, sir.
Am I audible, sir? Akshay Jadhav, sir.
Yeah, audible.
Okay, sir. I think no questions from the audience side.
Okay.
Now I take opportunity to propose vote of thanks to today's speaker, Dr. Vijay Bhaskar Sembwal, sir. Sir, thank you very much for accepting our invitation with a single call. All the time you are there to support us for such FDPs. Wherever we require your help, you are supporting us. Thank you for accepting our invitation from the College of Engineering, Pandharpur. Now, as you have covered the many wearable things like gait and different robots, you have studied, shown like how different applications, and you have shown different results also. Hope the participants are getting benefit of all these things. So if you have any queries further also, you can communicate to the sir related to this. He is going to always help to the faculties who are working on this area. And sir is always having a nature of supportive. So what I asked, right.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. And thank you all the participants. We are patiently listening the sessions from the this morning. Thank you from the wholeheartedly. I thank Bhaskar sir from the Department of Electronics and Telecommunications, Ferris College of Engineering, Pandharpur, and all the participants. Thank you, one and all. So today we are going to close the session here, and again tomorrow we will be meeting at 10 a.m. sharp. Right. Thank you, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you.